Dear friends, Mr. Mahanti sir has left about on the issue of web bill. Just to add 2-3 points on the web bill, because web bill is, as you know, is an enforcement measure. So it depends on the tax enforcement authorities to strictly enforce the web bill provisions while the goods are on the movement. And tax enforcement authorities means there are now two tax enforcement authorities. You must have already realized that there are two authorities for GST. One is state authorities, state commercial tax department, which was earlier doing the VAT, entry tax and all those things, which I represent. And the other tax administration is the CBEC, which was earlier doing the excise, service tax and customs. That is the Government of India tax department. So now there are two tax departments in the state. And for GST, both the tax departments should be, both the tax administrations should be involved. So these checkings should be carried out by both the administrations. Sometimes by us, sometimes by them, and sometimes jointly by both the administrations. As far as the assessees are concerned, I would request you that whichever state you belong to, in most of the states, the assessees have already been divided between the state tax administration and the central tax administration. 80% or 90% of the assessees have already been assigned to one of these two administrations. So please find out who is your tax administration. Because most of the time you come to us and nowadays we first see whether when you have come to me for a grievance, I first see whether you belong to, whether you are assigned to my jurisdiction or you are assigned to the Government of India's jurisdiction. If you are assigned to Government of India's jurisdiction, I would politely ask you to go and approach Government of India for all your queries. It is done because I may be in a position to address your queries. I may be in a position to clarify your doubts. But I would not be your authority. Tomorrow any audit, tomorrow any assessment, any notice, any communication will be done by the other department, other administration to whom you are assigned to. So therefore it is always better that you get the clarifications, you get your things sorted out by that administration so that there would be no contradiction at the time of audit or assessment. So first thing is that you find out to which administration you are assigned to. There is a doubt in most of the Government of India companies as well as state companies that Government of India PSUs are assigned to Government of India like CBEC and state PSUs are assigned to state administration. It is not a fact. It is not a fact. Like Odisha Mining Corporation, it is the largest state PSU. I think it is assigned to CBEC, not to Odisha state, not to us. Similarly, many CPSUs have been assigned to us. So that is the first thing you must find out. Second, coming back to web bill. So therefore, because web bill is an enforcement activity, here the tax administration division would not apply normally. When I go and check a truck on the road, the truck fellow cannot put a counter question to me. You first show me whether you are assigned to me or not. Because this is an enforcement activity and it's a checking activity, and we presume that every cargo that moves and which is required to carry a weigh bill must be carrying a weigh bill and other supporting documents. And even if that belongs to a particular dealer, and even if that dealer is assigned to say a CBEC, my officers have got every right on the road to stop that truck and ask for the details, ask for the documents to verify. Similarly, if the dealer is assigned to us, the CBEC officers on the road have got every right to stop the truck and ask for the invoices and weigh bill. Only when there is some discrepancy is observed and the question of taking action comes, then at that point of time, the officer should see whether this dealer is assigned to us or it is assigned to the other jurisdiction. Even if it is assigned to the other jurisdiction, if there is no anti-evasion activities taken up against the dealer in last 1 year, then the other administration can also initiate action against the dealer. So just I am driving home the simple point that this division of taxpayers is primarily not applicable to enforcement activities, primarily. There are some conditions, but primarily not applicable. But one condition is that if I catch hold of a truck pertaining to a dealer on the road and the dealer is assigned to CBEC, then what enforcement activity I carry on, I must intimate to the CBEC so that they would take care of that in the course of regular audit and regular assessment. Another doubt that is coming to everybody's mind is that what about RFID readers and all? Are all the trucks supposed to fit that RFID gadget and all those things? For the time being, it is not required. It is not mandatory. It is optional. On a futuristic date, we may ask the trucks and transporters to fit the RFID gadget on every truck or every transporting vehicle. And simultaneously, we should also have RFID readers installed on the roads. The idea is that if there is an RFID reader, then the truck can very well pass through without stopping, and the RFID reader will capture all the data from the RFID, and if it is all right, nobody would, the truck would in fact pass through, and nobody would stop the truck. If at all there is some discrepancy, the truck would be stopped maybe 10-20 kilometers ahead at some other point, but normally it will be a smooth pass through. There would be no physical stoppage of truck. But without RFID, how we are going to do the way bill enforcement? We would be physically stopping the vehicle. Okay, we would be physically stopping the vehicle. This you must know, because you are consultants. Most of the time, the dealers would ask you, ki sir, mera truck wahan pe atak gaya, kya karenge? The point is that when our people would be doing mobile duty on the roads, they have got every right. They will of course not stop every truck, unlike check gates, where every truck was stopping and every truck was showing the documents to pass through the check gate. Now on the mobile duty concept, maybe one truck in out of 100 trucks would be, as a sample, would be stopped and would be asked to give the documents, invoice or other documents and web bill, if it is supposed to carry a web bill. Once the web bill is given, then NIC, they are developing a mobile app. They have already developed a mobile app. So our officers would be having that mobile app in their smartphones, and they will enter the web bill number, and immediately they will see in their mobile app about the details of the web bill. And if it is all right, they will ask the truck to go. The truck can also carry the number only. It need not carry the web bill. It can only have the number. The driver might have written the number on his palm also. It is still permissible. He has to just show that this is my web bill number. Again, my officer on the smartphone would enter that number, and if immediately the system will throw the way bill in the smartphone, and if it is all right, then the truck will be allowed to pass through. If it is not all right, then punitive actions, all those penalties, etc., would be made applicable, subject to all the legal procedures. One condition is here that if a way bill has been checked in the state, then it will not be checked again in that state. How will it happen? Suppose a truck is coming from Kolkata and going to Chennai, and in the northern Odisha, it has been checked by Odisha officer, either Odisha government's officer or by CBC officer at Odisha. The truck is allowed to go. Truck comes to Bhubaneswar. Here also another officer stops it. Then the driver would say that, sir, my way bill has already been checked at Baleswar. But this statement cannot be accepted by the officer on its face value. So what the officer would do, the truck would be stopped. The officer would again enter the e-way bill number in the smartphone app. And in the smartphone app, it would be, the way bill will come. And below it will be, the information will come that it has already been checked at Baleswar. And the status of check was okay. Then this officer will let the truck go without asking any further question. Only exception is that if there is an intelligence, there is an information that from Baleswar to Bhubaneswar, in between he has done something, then this second officer has got every right to detain the truck and do the enforcement activities. Number three is, other subjects are of this session are audit, assessment and refund. Audit and assessment, I don't think time is ripe to discuss about audit and assessment. Now we are grappling with more fundamental issues of GSTR 1, 2, 3, invoice matching, etc. So I think I request Cost Accountant Institute to conduct similar function maybe after 2-3 months. At that point of time, we can speak more about audit and assessment. Now the other pertinent issue is refund. Admittedly, refund is not flowing the way it should be flowing. And admittedly, the refund circular that has been given now is not an ideal circular, because what was originally thought of, that refund would be applied online and in the whosoever jurisdiction the dealer is assigned to, that jurisdictional officer will process the refund application in the online GSTN platform, and if it is all right, he would sanction the refund for all the three acts. Because there is cross empowerment already in place, that means as an SGST officer, I am empowered to act under CGST and IGST. Similarly, for a CBEC, Government of India officer, who is as such empowered to act under CGST and IGST, he is also cross empowered under the state GST to also act as a competent officer. So this cross empowerment is already there. But unfortunately, the refund application has not yet been developed by the GSTN. As a result of which, what is the circular as it is standing today, it is that if you are assigned to me, you will apply for refund to me, and I would process your refund application. If it is all right, I will sanction the refund pertaining to state GST. Because I am a state GST officer, I would sanction the refund pertaining to state GST, and would intimate my counterpart in CBEC to do the needful for CGST and IGST. Once he gets intimation from me, he would not question the decision of mine. He would simply issue necessary refund orders under CGST and IGST. Similarly, vice versa. If you are assigned to CBEC administration, you give your refund application to them, they process it. If they find your application all right, they sanction the refund. They can only sanction the refund under CGST and IGST, then they will intimate us for sanctioning the refund under the state GST. This is a makeshift arrangement, but ultimately it is going to be done in the GSTN portal, where this cross referencing would not be required. If you are a dealer and you are assigned to me, then and I am a state officer, I will be ultimately sanctioning your refund under all the three acts. Similarly, if you are a dealer assigned to CBEC, CBEC jurisdictional officer would be sanctioning refund under all the three acts. That would ultimately happen, but please bear with us. That will take maybe a couple of months' time for the GSTN to develop that. As you know, GSTN is grappling with more fundamental problems in the portal, but that will ultimately going to happen. Currently, whatever manual applications we have received, CBEC also has received, yeah, we are trying to expedite. There was a little bit of problem and we are expediting, but yes, we admit that refund is not flowing the way it should flow. But we are expediting our systems. There are some treasury related issue. At least we have sorted out that. CBEC, I think Mahanti sir, CBEC has a problem in their fund sanction related issue. So that needs to be sorted out. Otherwise money, though we sanction the refund, money will actually not go from government exchequer to the dealer. So these are the basic issues, so I won't take much time. Mr. Mishra told me that railways officials are also present here. I do not know whether they are currently present or not. My request to railway officials is that we have already written to the railway heads of the three zones where Odisha is having operations. The e-way bill rule is also applicable to railways. What Mahanti sir said, that for a road transport, the consignee or the consigner has to generate the e-way bill. If the consignee or the consigner does not generate the e-way bill, then in case of road transport, the transporter has to generate the e-way bill. For railways, for air cargo, for vessel, there is a relaxation as far as the transporter is concerned. For railway, for air, for vessel, it is either the consignee or the consigner who has to generate the e-way bill, not the transporter. Okay, so for anything that is transported in railways, railway is not under the obligation to generate the e-way bill. It is either the consignee or the consigner who will generate the e-way bill. But railway has the responsibility of carrying the e-way bill. Any conveyance carrying goods worth more than 50,000, which is liable for a way bill, so the person in charge of the conveyance must carry the e-way bill. So when in addition to your RR documents and other things, please ensure that when you start booking your cargoes from 1st February onwards for interstate movement, ensure that the consignee or the consigner generate the UA bill, present it to you, then you do their RR and other things. Otherwise, we do not want that, but that should not happen, that law, one left hand of the government catches the right hand of the government on the wrong side of the law. Because in most of the time what happens in railways, the consignee consigner details are not there. Railways say that once we get our freight, we are not bothered so much about the consignee consigner details. The consignee consigner's VAT, TIN, GST, nothing is there in the RR. So that gives a tremendous scope for the consignee and consigner to evade tax. What they do, they carry goods in the railways, but then they don't show that in their transactions. So therefore, as Mahanti sir has said, EUA bill is going to be a revolutionary step, and it would leave a trail of every transaction. Therefore, we would request railway authorities to please ensure that your consignee, consigner generate way bill, and your railway parcel van or the leased van or the entire rick, along with its movement, must carry that way bill. Because maybe after, we may not go for checking of railways immediately from 1st February, but definitely we'll come to you, maybe after 15-20 days. Not so much to distrust you, but we have lot of bad experience with the consignee consigner bringing materials to railways. So if need be, please consult us. We can have a workshop for you so that we can explain you how these e-wayable systems can be implemented in railway. Because every GST is the biggest indirect tax reform. Everybody has to play its role to make it a success. Already it has become a success, but we have to make it more successful. So railway as the most important government of India or the government entity must also come forward to abide by the GST rules and regulations. It would also make your operation smoother. So please have an internal workshop, and please call us. We can jointly decide how railway can implement this e-way bill rule. Thank you.